What I really want to talk to you about is this. I came here to tell you to stop hiding and change the world. And I mean this quite literally. I really mean, if you stop hiding, the world will change. And I mean you, specifically you, the lab animal community. You have a very unique and special voice and role in all of this. And let's discuss that for a little bit, okay? Who are you exactly? Let's talk about who you are. Tell me if this is you. You believe that every single life has value, animals and people. Is that you? Yep. Is that you?
Yeah.
That's you, right? Who are you? You give everything you have to improve the quality of your animals' lives every single day. Is that you? Yes. And how do you do this? Amazing ways, right? You make sure they have clean and safe housing. You monitor their health. You ensure that they have beautiful veterinary care by competent, specially trained veterinarians who are used to doing this work, some of whom are boarded specially to do this work for our animals, right? You address their species' typical needs, right? Positive reinforcement training, environmental enrichment, and all of these things that you do, and interacting compassionately with these animals, forming bonds with them, good for you, all of these things that you do, decrease stress in these animals, decrease variability in the data, and basically what happens is that you people create reliable models. You people make or break the data. You do that. In fact, you people are the most important part of the research team. You are the reason that 6-year-old children with leukemia get to be 7. You are. You're heroes. You're heroes. So I have a question for you. Heroes, why are you hiding? I was listening to, and I won't say who it is, I was listening to a little bit of a conversation tonight over dinner. I didn't have a lot because I was nervous, as you know. And there's a young woman at the table who was going to say a few things tonight, and she was told by her employer that she is not to speak at this occasion. Because her boss is hiding. And many people in this room are in that same situation. Why are you hiding? You're heroes. Why are you hiding? Tell me, it's not rhetorical. And remember, I was a teacher, and I'm trained to wait. And then if I'm not satisfied with the amount of time it takes for me to get an answer, I call on people. So, so why are you hiding? Why? Someone. Drinkers.
The hospital says so.
The hospital says so. Why are they hiding?
Fear.
Fear. Right, you're hiding because you fear who?
The public.
The terrorists.
Them. Because you fear them. That's why you're hiding, right? Let's talk about them for a minute, okay? We allow them to lie about us. They say terrible things to the public, and these are some of them. They say that animal studies don't lead to cures, and the public believes them. They say we hate animals, and the public believes them. They say that we torture them and that we don't care about their suffering because we're heartless, because we're greedy, and we do it for profit, basically just because we're monsters. That's what they say about us. And what do we say? We say nothing. And there's a cost for allowing these lies, right? Let's look at this for a minute. Every 6 months or so, the Foundation for Biomedical Research does polls the public to ask them what their opinion of animal-based research is, and half of Americans don't support the work we do. Now, the interesting thing is that the numbers for women are a bit lower, about 10 or 15% lower, no matter what the average number comes out to be. And the thing that's really cool about that is they did a little digging around in the demographics to figure out, you know, who were these women? You know, who are these women that are so concerned about these animals in research? Who are they? Think about it. Who'd be concerned about these animals? Who are these women? Moms, right there. Mothers, exactly. And it makes a little bit of sense, right? What do mothers care about? What's important to them? Innocence. Compassion. Nurturance. Here's the thing, though. everyone, including them, the scary them, gets to brush their teeth, wash their hair, and clean their home using products deemed safe for their use because of necessary animal-based research. And everyone, including them, can go to Walmart or the newsstand or the sundry shop in the hotel or just about anywhere, 7-Eleven, the supermarket, and get some sort of over-the-counter medication to relieve their pain and discomfort for a headache, joint ache, gas pain. That might just be me. I live in Texas now, and it's a little different, but right? You can go anywhere and get all kinds of relief for all kinds of things, right? Or everyone, including them, can also walk into a pharmacy if they like and have at their disposal thousands of stronger medications to help relieve their pain and suffering related to much more serious illnesses, even those that may be fatal. Astounding. Everyone, including them, can do this because of necessary animal-based research. And everyone, including them, can go to the doctor and be evaluated for fractures, organ function, and a whole host of internal anomalies non-invasively without being cut open like in the old days. Everyone can do that, including them, because of necessary animal-based research. The world has changed in amazing ways because of necessary animal-based research. And half of America doesn't really think this is necessary. Half of America? Really? Half of America? That's a lot. How many people are there in America? I get a different number every time, but it's always close. How many? It's about 300 million. That means that 150 million people enjoying all of this modern convenience don't really think that animal work is necessary. Do you really believe that? We live in this media blitz. We're bombarded all the time, right? By all kinds of information, and it comes in from every angle, right? Newspapers, journals, TV shows, medical breakthroughs discussed on the news, and Dr. Oz. I can't stand hearing about Dr. Oz anymore, right? Magazines and journals that are everywhere, in the guidance counselor's office, right? In the doctor's office, at the hair salon place where this one sticks out a lot. But I did, right? Everywhere you turn, there's information. Just about everybody knows about knockout mice. And you're really going to expect me to believe, then, that half of America doesn't really believe this work is necessary? Do you believe that? 150 million people living under a rock somewhere, unaware of all of this information? I don't really buy that. I think there's probably a small fraction of Americans who don't think it's necessary. But people are funny. They can convince themselves of anything, right? A small fraction of Americans will sit around at a table and tell you that the Holocaust never happened or some other ridiculously awful thing, right? And never mind about the museums and the textbooks and all of the horrific documentation. They will sit and look you in the eye and tell you that it didn't happen. Because people are funny. They can do that. So some small fraction of Americans probably don't think this work is necessary. But half? Really? 150 million people? I don't think that's true. I think most Americans know that animals made all of this possible, and I think most Americans know that this work is necessary. They know. They absolutely know. They just feel guilty about it. And they feel guilty about it because they believe that they enjoy all of these modern conveniences on the backs of animals who are in the hands of heartless, greedy monsters. Now, guilt is a really, really huge burden. It's probably the worst thing you can feel, right? You don't go to sleep guilty and then just wake up the next day carefree. That doesn't happen, right? It sticks with you. It sticks with you, and you have to do something to get rid of it. It doesn't just go away on its own, right? You have to relieve that guilt, and I'm going to guarantee you that these people who are feeling guilty are not going to relieve it by refusing to take their critically ill child to the doctor when he's sick. They're not going to relieve their guilt that way, but they've got to do something because it bothers them, right? So they do things like this. They get together and they establish groups. Groups, and they're going to go out and they're going to start campaigning against animal cruelty, and they're going to form groups, and they're doing something about this problem, right? And then they're going to ask all of the other guilty Americans out there to donate to their cause. Donate. Do something about this, right? And it works. Humane Society of the United States, the largest animal activist organization in the country, without question. They take in about $200 million, mainly in just small donations from other Americans who are feeling really what?
Guilty.
Small donations, millions of people, right? PETA does the same thing. They take in about $30 million a year, mainly from small donations from people who are feeling like they need to do something. So that's what they do. Do they still go to the doctor? I'm sure of it. But they're doing something. Now, for some people, that's not enough. Their guilt is heavier. It's a real burden. And they have to do something more active, something stronger. So they go out and they stage these absolutely horrific protests, outrageous things, usually in a very public, invisible place with horrible graphic, embellished and distorted images, angry language. And they do this, this woman that stakes herself to a board, right? Covers herself up in red dye, which, by the way, was deemed safe for her use because of necessary animal-based research, right? To make a point, right? To do something. Now, that's pretty awful. But for some people, that's still not enough. And we read about more and more of this every day. For some people, that's not enough, and they take it a step further. And they relieve their guilt with violence and terrorist attacks, right? They come after us. They come after our families. They throw Molotov cocktails in cars and flood basements and mail razor blades to your home and threaten your children. Now, I am going to tell you something that you're not going to like, but it's the truth. You are partly to blame for all of this. You are partly to blame for all of this. And it's not just because you've been silent. You're partly to blame for this because not only have you nurtured silence, but you've nurtured these ridiculous, antiquated, time for them to go away, old school beliefs and practices. And I'm going to tell you what I mean right now. I want you to raise your hand, please, if during the course of your career in lab animal science, you have heard the following said to you. Don't name the animals. Raise your hand if you've heard that. And the rest of you are lying. Right. How many of you have heard this? Don't get attached to them. Raise your hand if you've heard that. Nearly everybody in the room, right? Here's one that always shocks me, and I heard this one. They're not pets. They're data points. Oh, my God. Raise your hand if you've heard that. There's a few of you. Wow. They're not pets. They're data points. The animals are data points. An attending veterinarian said this to me. He looked me right in the eye and said that to me one day because we had an animal who got sick, you know, just not study related, got sick, and we lost him. And the vet techs were really, really upset about it. And I was speaking to him about it because one of them was really struggling. She was really grieving, you know, and I thought maybe we could get some support, you know, for the vet tech group. And he said, oh, yeah, don't worry about that. I already spoke to her. I told her, you know, get over it. They're not pets. They're data points. And I'm not going to tell you what I said. I am from New York originally, so you can use your imagination and try and you know, and he's not there anymore, but I had nothing to do with that. I just couldn't believe it. And I was really puzzled because he was really a nice man. So it really threw me off. I couldn't figure out where he was coming from with this. And then I realized it was a part of his training. That's part of that old school training. He was proud when he said that to me because he thought he was upholding the code. That's what you're supposed to say. Preach detachment. And that's what he was doing. They're not pets, they're data. He called our animals data points. Well, they're not data points. They're beautiful and alive, and we do name them. And we do get attached. And we do cry when they're gone. And we go home and we process that grief and we come back the very next day to show the same love and compassion to those who remain because we also feel compassion for him. And for her. And for this sweet little angel right here. You have to share your truth with the public. They don't even know who you are. They don't know who you are. They only know what they've heard. And the activists have been very busy painting a really horrible image in the minds of the public. And that's what's there. Now, when you start sharing your truth, your job is to change that picture. When you talk to the public, tell them what you do, but more importantly, tell them how you do it. Tell them why you do it. Tell them how you feel about what you do. Tell them how you feel about your animals. Tell them the stories about your animals. You hear them all the time. Nobody in Lab Animal can get together without talking about some goofy thing that Elmer the dog did, right? You know, or Jabba the rat, I heard about him today, did, right? They're hilarious, and we love them. Tell them those stories. And tell them the other stories, too, because they're going to ask you in the middle of your conversation about the bad stuff. And let them see that emotion. Let them see how you really feel, that you really care about these animals, because you do, or you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't be doing what you're doing because it's hard. It's very hard on your heart. Tell them that, and they get a new picture, right? They have a brand new image. And here's the whole thing about that. You don't have to argue with anyone. This is not about a fight. It's about awareness. It's about sharing your truth. Nobody knows who you are. You just have to tell them. You don't have to argue with anybody. You just tell them. And then off they go on their merry way, right? And the next, now they have this beautiful image in their head of you and Elmer the dog, right? The beagle, who Elmer liked glue because he was always, wouldn't leave you alone, stuck to you, right? Cute, right? That's the picture they have, right? And now here comes Mr. or Mrs. Activist, and they get a hold of someone in the public, and they start talking about you, and they say, they're heartless. And in their mind, they see this. Well, that doesn't really add up. It just starts to fall on deaf ears, right? They're greedy. They do all this work for profit. But in their mind, they've heard your story, and this is what they see. Positive reinforcement training to help pigs cooperate for the study, right? They're monsters. But in their mind, they've heard your story, and this is what they see. Does that man look like a monster to you? I'm going to tell you a little story about this man. This is R. Jerome with one of his babies, and I mean his babies, and don't even try to tell him that they're not all his, because they are. Even yours are his. And you probably heard about Hurricane Ike a couple years ago. It went into the Gulf, and it just trashed the coast and trashed Texas, and it was really bad. And, of course, you know, we had a ride-out team and all that. A couple days before the storm hit, one of our sows had babies. And Jerome was there because he's always there. He's like a midwife, and he takes care of the runts and all of that. He just really loves these animals. And of course, the storm came, and he was home. He wasn't on the ride-out team. And I was worried, you know, so I gave him a call to see how he was doing and to let him know that don't worry about the babies, we're here, we'll take care of them. And I couldn't get a hold of them. All the cell towers were down, you know, all of this stuff. And so a little while went by, maybe 30, 40 minutes, and I get a call on my office phone from an inside line. I'm like, oh my God, who's that? It's Jerome. He came in, and he lives about an hour and a half from us when there isn't 4 to 8 feet of water in the road, right? Live wires, I mean, really dangerous. This man came into work to be with his babies. And I said, hey, Jerome, you know, how's your family? How's your house? He said, oh, it's not so good. An enormous tree fell and crushed Jerome's roof and was now sitting in his bedroom. And his family was sitting in the house with a big hole in the sky. And he said, I have to go to work and take care of the babies. And they said, okay. Now, if I tell you that man is a monster, are you going to believe me? No. Now, this is the part of the talk that really intrigues me, because I wasn't expecting this to happen. I was putting the talk together, and I was pouring through images to use, and as I was looking around and sorting through things to put on the slides, I found this picture. And it was this really powerful moment for me. It was this, you know, one of these aha moments where you just kind of get hit on the head with something that never occurred to you before, right? This is an image of a poster from the Animal Liberation Front. It's a very extreme activist organization. These are the people that go in and vandalize labs and burn property, right, and release the animals and steal the animals. Very, very aggressive, violent group. And this is a poster of one of their members. And I took this image, and I looked at it, and I put it right next to my image of Jerome, and I just sat there and marveled at it for quite some time. Because look at it, right? Each one of these men thinks the other one is a monster. And yet, look at these pictures. Look at the tender hands holding that baby. Look at them holding the baby up to their heart, right? Look at the peace on the face of each one of these men as they hold that beautiful little life in their hands. They look what? Say it out loud. They look the same, don't they? And this is the aha moment. That is not a freak coincidence. It's not a freak coincidence because the obvious truth that's been in front of our faces all of this time is that on a very fundamental level, we are all motivated by the same thing. We all love these animals. In that way, we're the same. We have just been so caught up in our differences and the details of those differences and being right and being wrong that we've lost sight of it completely. And I'm going to tell you something in typical New York fashion. The animals really don't care about the pissing contest. Now, I just want you to think about something, and I'm not going to go on and on about this point, but it was a really powerful moment for me. I just want you to think about something. Human beings seem to be hardwired to do this. I'm right, you're wrong. I'm right, you're wrong, right? We're hardwired for that. I want you to think about something. I want you to imagine what it would be like if, in every aspect of life and the human condition, if before we got together to have a conversation with someone about something we disagreed on, if before we did that, we consciously and deliberately got ourselves in the mindset of thinking about how we're the same. What are our common goals? If we got ourselves in that mindset before we sat down and have a conversation, and so did the other person, and then we sat down at the table and talked, I think and I hope that we might actually have some solutions and suggestions instead of just a bunch of arguing and yelling and screaming, which hasn't made a difference because what's the percentage of Americans that support animal-based research? 50%, right? About. I think if we could get in that mindset, we might make a little more headway. If it's really true that the love for animals is really at the heart of our motivation. Anyway, I just want you to think about it. I didn't mean to make this all heavy and all that other stuff, but I do want you to think about it. You have to relieve the guilt with your truth, right? The public feels guilty, and you hold the secret. Your truth is compassion, love and compassion for all living things, for animals and people, right? You, see, this is the interesting thing. You are the missing link. You are. You're the bridge to understanding. You are that reassuring kiss on the forehead that the public is begging for as they struggle in their hearts with the cost of progress. You are, and you can fix this. All you have to do is become real. You just have to become real. You have to exist. They have to know who you are. They have to know your stories. Now, a lot of people are running around telling everybody, in lab animal especially, in research, go out there and start talking to people. Get out there and tell them who you are and what you're doing. And that's a little irresponsible without a little bit of guidance, right? And I'm going to tell you why. Every single little word that you say to someone in the public has to be just right. Because the activists have been doing this for a long, long time. And they have deliberately used words that trigger these horrible images that we were talking about in the minds of the public, right? They've been at it a long time. And you haven't. You haven't said anything. And so we're not on a level playing field when it comes to this. And what that means is that one use of the wrong word, one, will bring up the ugly picture in their minds. And once that ugly picture is there, it really doesn't matter what you say. All you're going to get is this. Forget it. It's not going to happen. So the words have to be very carefully chosen. So let's just go through them very briefly. Now, I want to, before we start, remind you that what I'm talking about here is that very initial conversation, right? And you get on the bus, you know, or the train, you know, or you're standing in line somewhere, waiting to buy your Powerball ticket. Maybe that's just me. I was online twice. And I still didn't win anything. That's why I'm here. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'd be here anyway. No, I would. I'd just be wearing nicer shoes. I'd buy you all shoes, in fact. See, I'm a nice person. Can I please win the Powerball? Anyway, I want to remind you that this is that first conversation you have with someone. The person who says, hey, you know, what do you do, right? That person you sit on the bus next to every day that finally says, hey, where are you headed? What do you do? What is it you do exactly? Your job in this conversation is very simple. The only thing you are to do initially when you have this conversation is to change that picture. Remember? That's your job. Change the picture. Once you change the picture, then your conversation may get a little more involved. And depending on the questions you're asked and how interested this person is and how ready this person is to know the truth, then I encourage you to be very, very transparent about all of it. And while you're doing that, make sure that your emotion is there. Don't make this a cerebral conversation, because it doesn't matter if it's cerebral. Nobody cares. The activists have an advantage in all of this because they have appealed to the emotion of the public. And our traditional response has been to get up there from somebody like the director of some university, a president of some university, or some researcher, speaking from their big cerebral brain, saying all of these really cerebral, obvious things like, well, we need to do this because it leads to cures. And then they go into all the scientific babble, like the gentleman Patrick, who came up here a moment ago and didn't even know what he was talking about. It's just exactly like that. And the public doesn't care. And the truth is they already know. They already know that this work leads to cures. That's not a surprise. That's not what they care about. And that's not why they're upset. What they want to know is, do you care about these animals? How do you feel about them? So make sure that that is in your conversation. Okay, so your initial conversation with someone. When you're having a conversation with someone, don't say in the course of that conversation, oh, well, I use animals to do X, Y, Z. Why? What's wrong with saying that? I use animals to do X, Y, Z. And this is funny because we don't think about this because we already know how we feel about animals, right? And so these words don't mean anything to us. But if you're in the public and all you've heard about is that we don't care about these animals and we're detached and we objectify them, then some of these words are really, really stinging, right? Oh, well, I use animals. What's wrong with that? How's that sound? Use, like what? Like what? Like a tool, right? It's objectifying, right? You use a broom to sweep the floor. You use a screwdriver to fix things. I don't know. I don't do that either. Right? Right. Yes, a very objectified. Don't say you use animals. And what do you do? Oh, well, I use animals to study cancer, cures for cancer. Instead, say, I work with animals. Well, I work with transgenic mice. And these mice happen to be very unique because they model breast cancer. And they really have helped us come a long way in understanding how to treat breast cancer. And so we're really excited about it. Doesn't that sound better? You work with them. You don't use them. Okay, don't say that. That right away, you know what's going to happen when you say that word? Oh, I use animals. Awful person. Don't talk to them again. Who cares what they do? Right? There's the picture. Okay, another one. Don't say you do research on animals. Sounds funny now, but I hear it all the time. You're probably just saying it a minute ago. Right? What do? I do research on monkeys. Oh my God, that sounds horrible, right? Why? Why does it sound horrible? Just a little word, on. Why does it sound horrible?
Because you're using them.
Because you're using them. Again, it's an objectifying term, right? I do research with monkeys, or I do research with rats. Rats are a really good model for studying learning and memory disorders. And we're learning a lot about cognitive function by working with these animals. Now, how does that sound? But what you don't want to do is say, I do research on rats so I can understand Alzheimer's disease, because when you say that little word on, the picture comes back, right? It's not really a collaboration. But your initial job is to change the picture. And then as you continue on in your discussion and more of the details come out, the person you're speaking to is going to come to appreciate why this work is necessary. And what they're really going to appreciate is that you really care about these animals you're working with, and you're tremendously grateful for what it is they are allowing you to do for animals and people. What you do is beautiful. The vast majority of the public are pretty scientifically naive, I would say. Wouldn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Now, every single one of those people has probably seen Young Frankenstein. And when you say this word, what image comes to mind? Yeah, right, Gene Wilder. Lab coat, hair, right? Things in the lab, bubbles and gases flying everywhere. Somebody's head in a vat, having a conversation with you, right? Crazy, awful stuff, carving up people and mixing up their body parts and all this other stuff, right? That's what comes to mind. It's an awful, awful word. And as soon as you say it, oh my God, not only going to get the pit, they'll probably run away from you. I do experiments with them. You know what's interesting? The activists intentionally use this word multiple times. If you read anything they write, you'll see that they stick that word in there intentionally. Experiments, experiments, the experimenters, and then the other awful words they use. Because every time they say it, this horrible thing comes to mind. And they know that. They've been so clever. They know that these words cue vile images in the minds of the public. And as long as they keep saying them, the pictures come up. That's why they need something else, right? Don't say you do experiments on animals. Say you do studies with animals. What do you do? Well, we do studies. Studies with a whole host of mice that are giving us some really tremendous information about possibilities of how to really address some of the symptoms related to Parkinson's disease. Or any other example you can think of. That sounds way different, and it's true. All you're doing is avoiding the ugly word. When you talk about animals, don't call them its. And I know when you write a paper for a journal, because I went through this my whole graduate school career, and I still can't believe, I think they gave me a degree to get rid of me, because I used to fight tooth and nail about this. Don't call Danny he. Well, he is a he. Well, you can't call him that in the Journal of Neuroscience. Why not? He's a he. It's the whole thing, right? I know when you write something formally, you have to call them its. But you do not and should not use that term when you speak to another human being in the public who cares about animals. When you have conversations among yourselves, you use their names and you call them he's and she's. I heard it all day today. I had the distinct pleasure of being at Bristol-Myers Squibb this morning. It was a fantastic facility with a bunch of amazing people, and I really enjoyed myself. And they have all these really adorable pictures of animals around the facility welcoming you to their home, which is this really beautiful culture of care campaign. You don't refer to them that way among yourselves, and you should never refer to them that way to the public. And why not? Why not the animal? Why not it? It's objectifying. It's the same exact thing. Call them your animals, right? They're our animals. They're their animals. And when you use words like our animals, there's something else that happens. When someone listens to that and you call them your animals, what else do they feel from you?
Connection.
A connection, care,
compassion,
our animals, love, okay, yeah. Accountability, ownership and accountability. When you use a word like that, it's a very powerful little word. You're saying to someone, look, these animals mean something to me. I'm accountable for them. I have ownership and responsibility over their lives. That's a very powerful word, way better than the or it. Okay, another word, or another clue, another hint. Don't use their words, and by them and their, I mean the activists. Don't use any of them, even if it's to defend yourself, right? This has maybe happened to you. It's happened to me before. Someone asked me what I do, and which always happens to me. Even when I'm trying deliberately to ignore everybody around me, it happens to me. I'm not really quite sure why. I guess maybe so I'd have something to talk about tonight. As soon as you say what you do, and this has happened to me a couple times, someone will say, oh, you're one of those people that tortures animals, right? They'll say that to you, right? And what I want to say is, because I'm from New York, no, you idiot. I don't, you know, but I don't, because it's not smart. The bottom line is, remember what I told you about these words. Every time the word is said, the picture comes up. Don't use their words, even if it's to refute them about it. Don't say, no, I don't. Don't say the T word, right? Don't say it at all. Just ignore it completely, because every time the word is said, the picture comes up. And if you say it, the picture's going to come up. And when the picture comes up, you can't speak to anybody anymore. Game over, right? So just don't use them. You have plenty of your own words to use. I heard so many incredible things this evening, right? Canine familiarization programs, environmental enrichment, compassion, stories about your animals. There are all kinds of great things, grieving about your animals. There are all kinds of beautiful things that you can talk about in your own words that will be much more effective. You don't need to use their words. Stay away from them. You're building a new awareness here. They're learning about who you are. Okay, the last thing I want to mention. And again, this is when you are first having a conversation with somebody in the public. You're sitting next to them on the bus, right? When you're talking about the activists, don't call them animal rights anything. Because if they're right, you're what?
Wrong.
And when you talk about somebody protecting somebody's rights, they're usually protecting them against some horrible human being who's infringing upon them, right? And that would be who? You. Right. So don't say that. Just call them activists. Or better yet, call them extremists. Or call them terrorists, because that's what they are. Don't attribute any nobility to them by using that word. These are little tiny words, but I hope they've given you something to think about because they make a big difference, and you'll know it. You will know the second you say the wrong word because this is what you'll see. Think about your words, very important. All right, the next slide I put together to address the other big thing that we struggle with when we talk to the public, right? And that's the, so what do you do? question, right? Raise your hand if you've been asked this question before and really had no idea what you were going to say to that person. Raise your hand. Yeah, everybody in this room should be raising their hand. The rest of you are lying or probably too drunk now or asleep to answer me. Right, right. That's a hard one, right? I ask this question all the time, and I'm always amazed. How many of you have been in relationships with people and you weren't really completely honest about what you did? Raise your hand. Oh, really? Nobody in this room lied to their partner? Okay, there we are. A couple truth tellers. Right. How many people in this room have family members who don't really know what you do? Raise your hand. Yeah, some of you. That's a really awkward thing, right? It's a really awkward thing. Well, it's awkward for all the reasons we discussed. So what I did is I put together a little example dialogue for you to look at. And again, if you send me an email, I'll send it to you. And I just want you to take a look at it, think about it, mull it over, maybe tweak it to your liking. It's a little something, at least, to get you started being comfortable about speaking to people about what you do. And it incorporates all of the things we just discussed, right? So you're sitting next to someone on the bus, and they say, so what do you do? You could say this. I care for those animals who care for us all. That sound great? I care for those animals who care for us all. And they're going to say, what on earth does that mean? Right. And you're going to say, well, do you know anyone being treated for an illness or a chronic disease? Any friends or relatives? And they're going to say, why? Oh, yeah, sure. And you're going to say, okay, well, is the treatment helping? And they're probably going to say, what? Yeah, seems so, right? And you're going to say, well, I care for those animals who make that possible for all of our loved ones, including our pets. And they're going to say, oh, are you a, fill in the blank, researcher. Usually they're going to say, are you a researcher? Are you a researcher or a vet, right? Oh, are you a researcher? And you're going to say, no. Researchers study diseases and develop treatments. My job is to give research animals the best quality of life I can while they are with us. And they're going to say, how do you do that? Right. And then you're going to say this. You're going to say, by providing for their physical and emotional needs with compassion and respect. And when you say that, they will be listening to the next thing you have to say. Compassion and respect. Powerful, right? Do you feel like you got a little something, a little armed? Good, because we're going to go out, not right now, it's not a wet lab. We're going to go out, and we're going to start having these conversations with people. And then amazing things are going to happen. Really amazing. Things that we probably aren't even thinking about now are going to happen, because public awareness is a powerful thing. And when people know the real truth, They're going to be armed with information they haven't had before, and it's going to change the way they spend their money, and it's going to change the way they vote, and it's going to change the way they interact with each other, and it's certainly going to change the way they interact with us. And for the first time in their lives, they're going to be held accountable for their own choices. Because the other truth of this is that they drive the market that we work in. We do all of this for people and animals, including those people. And they don't even know that, right? What they like is to pretend that they can have all of these modern-day conveniences, and they come from absolutely no place. They just happen, right? And awareness is going to change all of that. It's going to be quite interesting. And other people are going to be held accountable. Other people you may not even think about. Big things can happen, things we're completely unaware of. And so it's time. It's time to change the world. It's time to move it away from blame and anger and hatred and violence and move it instead into the direction of compassion and love.